one of the three deputy governors in 2005 and lead the Bank Supervision Division. Less than a month before he assumed the role of central bank governor on July 1st, 2017, Nestor Espinilla Jr. granted the boss an exclusive interview. Good to have you with us, Governor Espinilla. Thank you so much for joining us here on The Boss.
Thank you very much, Kathy, for having me for your interview.
So what's it been like following the announcement?
Well, it's been a blur, actually, after the announcement. So the pace clearly picked up, and there are lots of things to think about. Of course, I still have my normal responsibility as the current deputy governor in charge of basically banking supervision, so that's a very busy assignment. At the same time, I have to already prepare for transition.
Bay inflation has come in at 3.1%, slower than forecast, slower than April, and well within the forecast of the central bank target range. What is your outlook for inflation?
We were anticipating inflation to accelerate a little bit towards the beginning of the year. And we expected it to taper down as we go through the middle of the year. So the most recent data point is consistent with that view. And our inflation outlook continues to suggest that the inflation path will be well inside our inflation target.
The peso now hovers at a 10-year low. What do you make of the pace at which it's traded against the U.S. dollar, which has strengthened in the past couple of months?
From my perspective, the peso has remained relatively stable. To begin with, we have continued to stick to our perspective that we let the market determine the setting of our exchange rate. And that has actually happened in the context of a stable financial system. And I think there is considerable confidence in our economy at this point of time. That's a fact. That's a combination of many elements, the quality of economic policy, where it is being taken, and also the overall stability of the political situation in the Philippines. So, for example, I think the government is doing a very responsible thing in focusing on tax reform, which will be fundamentally good for the stability of our macroeconomic fundamentals.
Would it be fundamentally inflationary when you talk about the tax reforms?
It would seem that there could be a slight impact on inflation in the short run, but it's not expected to be persistent. It should dissipate fairly quickly. Over the medium term, it's going to be positive to the extent that it lowers risk premia, it enhances confidence in the economy. It can only be positive for the country.
How short is short term? When you mentioned the inflationary impact of the tax reforms.
Okay, so these are estimates by economists. So there could be, since if the tax reform package takes effect in 2018, so there could be a small impact over the baseline in 2018, and that's expected to dissipate by 2019. So that's really the assessment that we're looking at on this. So we don't see the tax reform as a threat to the inflation, the management of inflation.
Now you're coming in at a time that monetary policy is now being deployed through the interest rate corridor. How are you going to manage that, to follow through and manage the term deposit facility as a main tool to strengthen the transmission mechanism of monetary policy?
Okay, so the interest rate corridor system is the approach that has that BSP has now taken to conduct monetary policy. So it's the big advantage of that is that it takes us closer, or not closer, but more into a market-oriented determination of market prices, particularly interest rates. And as you know, monetary policy operates through our policy rates affecting market rates, and then ultimately that one affecting variables such as output and inflation. So it's a complicated chain. But to the extent that through this IRC system, we are able to influence the movements of money market rates as they respond to our policy signals in the setting of policy rates, then that enhances the efficacy of monetary policy.
But you'd still push for the amendment to the BSP charter?
Yes, most certainly. That's very much part of the advocacy of the BSP with our Congress, and that seems to be gaining traction. So we are reasonably confident that we'll be able to get the amendments in place, which will then allow us to conduct monetary policy with even greater efficiency and effectiveness.
The global ransomware attacks, I mean, that affected the whole world, and it also raised some issues here. I know that you issued a memorandum circular, but to what extent did the supervised financial institutions nearly get attacked?
You know, you have identified another area to be extremely mindful of. So there are things to worry about money laundering, etc., and the safety and soundness of our banking system. But the element of cybersecurity risk is a new element and a significant one too. And it can hit the best of our financial institutions. So what is our best posture in that sense? So obviously a reactive posture will not do the system any good. So what we need to do is to create a system that's able to prevent it, but also at the same time be resilient to it. And we had issued a series of regulations dating back as early as 2013 when we laid out the IT risk management framework for banks and other BSP-regulated financial institutions. And that's work in progress. We are continuing to enhance that. We are about to come up again soon with an enhanced framework for technology risk management, particularly focused on fending off cybersecurity threats. So ransomware attacks, unfortunately, they seem to be increasingly a fact of life. It will happen. Institutions can get attacked. But what's more important is they are able to resist this and are not compromised in their operations. And from the recent ransomware attack globally, we're happy to say that our banking system had not been affected to the point that they get disrupted. The institutions probably may have been attacked because this is a global threat, but I think the more important point is, were they compromised? They were not.
I know that there is an interest on your part to ease foreign exchange restrictions. It's something that the Thai Central Bank had already done this week, is to actually ease foreign restrictions to aid businesses. How do you plan to go about that?
The initiative to introduce more reforms in the manner in which we manage our foreign exchange system is one major initiative. It warrants focus, and we have specific initiatives. But the other one about the entry of technology into financial space, digital finance, that's another big topic, an exciting one, I must say, and it will also occupy a lot of our time in the coming years. From the perspective of ease of doing business, there are a lot of good reasons to be able to let businesses transact in foreign currency efficiently through the formal financial system. So that's one good motivator. Another perspective is we'd like to discover the true prices of commodities, and currency is the peso dollar. It's a market that you want to make it as efficient as possible, so that it can send the right signal, so that will guide people into action. We also take a strategic perspective that to the extent that there is a lack of balance in the regulatory arrangements, we don't want to drive, or we don't really want business to happen in the shadows. So we would like to encourage these kinds of legitimate transactions to happen in regulated financial markets where there is transparency, where there is consumer protection, and we are also able to capture data. Data is very important because that informs overall policy making. So these are very good reasons why we need to continue to forge ahead with reforms in foreign exchange system in the Philippines. So a circular was issued last year. So that is, to my mind, work in progress. That's going to be part of a continuing agenda in the coming years.
So where does fintech come in, and how does that actually promote what your advocacy has really been, financial inclusion?
Increasingly, the BSP has become deeply committed to the agenda of financial inclusion in the early 2000s. It began, that journey began with our support for microcredit. So it was very narrowly defined back then, microcredit. Then that segued into microfinance. Microfinance began to encompass the savings side of it. And then financial inclusion then became the broader agenda, and that encompassed the total delivery of financial services, be that in remittances, insurance, savings, and credit. So, and the whole point of that agenda is to basically leave no one behind. So we have today a very strong financial system, but at the same time, you need to consider that to what extent does it truly serve the overall public? So there are limitations to date, and fintech comes in as an opportunity to enhance the delivery of that of the financial services such as that we have, and improve the quality and the experience of customers. So that is a matter that traditional banks have not been so good at delivering right now, notwithstanding their stability. So fintech, both as partners of banks and as service providers in their own right, can cover that gap. And that's especially important in a geography like the Philippines. As you know, we are an archipelago, fragmented islands, infrastructure challenges. So digital finance is a way of delivering financial services in a cost-effective manner, as well as in a timely manner.
Now, with about a month to go, how is wife Tess preparing for the new role? Because when we talked to you the day after your announcement as the next governor, you said that the very first person you approached was your wife, because she was going to suffer with you.
Well, we have always dealt with life as a partner, so together. So we've always done things together from the time we first met each other in university. So we've always treated each other with professional respect. She knows what she knows, I know what I know. So we take comfort in each other's support. So that's why where I was coming from. So obviously the job of being the governor of the BSP is a big job. I have big shoes to fill as well. So it requires a lot of effort, and and along the way there will be challenges, and those challenges are going to be a heavy burden to carry by yourself. So at least I have one to share it with.
But she manages the money at home.
Oh,
so
yes.
She's the governor at home.
Oh yes, she's the governor at home. So I know where my limitations are, and she's a CPA, a professional in her own right. So she has knowledge of these things, and she's also a great advocate of financial inclusion. So so we've got each other well covered.
I know that your dad's been pretty generous, but your mom really was the one who tightened the purse strings and taught you a lot about financial management.
Well, they're both passed on right now. So the value of being a good provider and taking care of your family, that was a clear message of my father. The value of managing your money based on what you've got, that was the clear lesson that I got from my mother. So between these two lessons in life, so that has, in a way, taught me good values.
When we come back, a subject he describes closest to his heart, the digitalization of finance, promoting his advocacy on financial inclusion. We'll be right back.
Good evening, I'm Ron Cruz with the latest this hour. President Rodrigo Duterte vetoes a bill banning corporal punishment on children. Executive Secretary Salvador Medeldeo confirmed the president will return the measure to Congress, where it can override a veto with a two-thirds vote. Opposition Senator Riz Ontiveros filed the bill, which she says aims to promote a non-violent way to discipline children. A 2011 Pulse Asia survey showed 2 in 3 parents discipline their children through corporal punishment. Malaysian Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad will make a two-day visit to the Philippines next week. Manila's Foreign Affairs Department says Mahathir will arrive in the Philippines on March 6th and will meet with Mr. Duterte for bilateral talks the following day. Mahathir and Duterte last met in July last year in Malaysia, where they both agreed to further bolster their security cooperation in Southeast Asia. Mahathir is also scheduled to meet with Senate President Vicente Soto III and House Speaker Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. The Malaysian leader last visited the country during the administrations of former Philippine Presidents Corazon Aquino and Fidel Ramos. And here's what you can expect on The World Tonight at 9.
Later on The World Tonight, critics slam President Rodrigo Duterte for doubting the Marcoses' amassed ill-gotten wealth. The race for the coveted House Speaker post in the 18th Congress heats up even before the midterm polls in May. And the second summit between U.S. President Donald Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un ends abruptly without a deal on denuclearization. These and more in The World Tonight at 9.
Those are the latest. Stay tuned for The World Tonight.
A year and a month on, Governor Espinilla grants the boss another exclusive interview on August 24th, 2018. And in that final one-on-one conversation, he generously shared his journey battling with this medical condition while promoting tirelessly progress he's making on broadening financial inclusion. Good to have you back on The Boss, Governor Espinilla. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me again.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it was the last year when I had you. You were still the incoming governor. So it's been more than a year.
A lot of things happened, but it was pretty much what I expected it would be. I didn't have any visions that the life of a governor would be a walk in the park.
Definitely
so
not one.
I come prepared for this job.
But how's your health? You've had a bit of a curveball a couple of months ago.
So that has added to the complication of being governor. But with God's grace, I've been able to recover, and the recovery continues. So I look forward to full recovery down the road.
You know, I still remember that blast text you sent in February, and you were in Israel.
Yep.
You were in a pilgrimage with family and friends.
Yes, I just completed my treatment then. And I thought, actually, we had planned for that a long time ago, a year ago, before I got announced as governor, before I got sick. And the idea was, whatever happens, it will be a good a trip to do together with close friends, to an opportunity to do pilgrimage and thank God for all the blessings. And I decided that there's no need to postpone it, so I went ahead. And and that was a life-changing activity.
What did you pray for?
Everything, for wisdom, for better health, for the country, for family.
What was it like, the journey of surviving cancer, and as you've just come in as central bank governor?
Well, it's something that was never in my plans. So many things were racing in my mind, including how I would manage the schedules, how I would tell the public about it, how they would take it, how markets would take it, and most importantly, my family, how they would take it, and also walk with me on that journey. And in the end, things were worked out pretty well, in my view.
And what difference a year makes? 3 rate hikes, a full percentage point in total in a span of 4 months. We're talking May, June, and August. What event risks are you looking at more closely now? Is it global macro, that includes monetary policy to trade wars, or is it local inflation?
Well, all of the above, Kathy. as you know.
All in priority.
Well, I have the immediate challenge at hand is the domestic one. So right now we're facing elevated risks on inflation. Of course, the origins of that has something to do with supply side factors. But nonetheless, it has created a dynamic of its own. And the BSP certainly needs to deal with that to reassure the public that, well, we may not be able to hit our inflation target this year, but we certainly would hit it next year. And that's the reason why we implemented those rate hikes. And we continue to closely monitor the situation so that we'll be able to act in an expeditious manner. What has complicated the picture really is that there's these outside factors that are impinging on policy decisions, primarily to the exchange rate channel. So things like what's happening in Turkey, the trade wars, etc. This create an element of uncertainty. And together with the normalization in advanced economies, like particularly the US, so this is putting additional pressure. So we have to deal with that as well.
So what's the bigger driver on inflation? Is it global crude or train tax package one?
Global crude, without doubt, is the key driver of the inflation numbers that we are seeing today. This was precisely the situation that we saw back in 2008, when inflation likewise spiked to around 8% range.
But WTI and Brent have already fallen over the past couple of weeks, so wouldn't that make Train's tax package one the bigger driver of inflation?
No, I think with oil prices starting to come down, this will help the forecast that we put forward, that we do anticipate inflation to come down moving forward. And the impact of Train, we've always said in the earlier analysis, yes, it will have an impact. It will tend to be moderate, and it will be relatively short term. So it will dissipate as well, because you know inflation is a rate of change. And given that the excise taxes have already been imposed, so it's going to dissipate over time.
Was the cost of raising rates low enough compared with the loss of credibility of the BSP to the markets?
I don't know about loss of credibility. As you know, the BSP decides on these things on the basis of a very careful assessment of the data. We spend an enormous amount of time looking at various facets of the information that is available to the BSP. I would say that the BSP actually would probably have much better information than many other analysts out there. It may be a burden that you have all of this, that you have to weigh this carefully and determine which one is the most important set of numbers at any given point of time. But it imposes a discipline on the process, and we adhere to that careful discipline of being guided by the numbers, not by sentiment, not by public clamor or emotion. We have to calculatedly look at those numbers.
Alongside the rate cutting, you've slashed banks' required reserves twice, and that added $200 billion in liquidity to the financial system. In hindsight, do you think that the cut came too soon?
What I think I should point out is that there was a reason for cutting the reserve requirement. And it's coming down to our objective as well. We're also keen to develop the domestic market. That's important if we want to have sustainable growth in the long run. Now, there's never a timing for these things. never a good timing. So the timing that we chose is that we have developed the interest rate corridor system, and we're able to conduct monetary policy using this new, more market-friendly approach. So insofar as the reserve requirement cut is concerned, so yes, we released at the first instance liquidity into the system, but we promptly reabsorbed that back into the open market instruments that we deployed through the interest rate corridor system. As a matter of fact, the total liquidity of the system has gone down from 14% growth to now just a little over 11% growth. Just to show you that our instruments are quite effective in absorbing liquidity that was released through the reserve requirement cut. So the issue that excess liquidity triggered more inflation is not correct from that perspective.
Is the economy already overheating?
No, the economy is not overheating. But what we are dealing with is that there are extra challenges on top of immediate supply side issues.
What strides have you made since with financial inclusion? Because you've already set up the financial technology subsector in July.
Okay, so now you're opening a subject that is very close to my heart. So, you know, when I first got appointed and I was asked, what's the agenda? I said continuity plus plus. And then continuity is what we've been discussing for the past couple of minutes about keeping inflation low and stable. That's a primary mandate of the BSP. But we're also keen to promote the plus plus of it, which is to develop the financial system in many ways, not just for debt, not just for efficiency, but also for inclusiveness. And financial inclusion is something that we have been espousing even before I became governor. But the new element, the element that excites me, is that now we are approaching it with the digitalization team. And that's going to address many of the pain points that we have seen over the years. Issues of providing financial services with more affordability and ease of access, simply because we are challenged by the fact that our geography is not easy and there are many physical infrastructure challenges in the country that make it simply difficult to reach out and put branches all over the country. But now, with technology and the fact that a lot of our people are very digital savvy, particularly to the mobile phones, that's a great opportunity to be able to deliver financial services. But what's important is to have a good strategy. And the good strategy is the National Retail Payment System. We're basically building financial rails, infrastructure, or what we call finfrastructure, rails wherein payments can pass through, either for remittances, for paying one's bills, for providing credit, obtaining savings, distributing investment products. So we're building the highways that will connect every Filipino to every Filipino on an account by account basis.
But before you get to digitalization, you need a national ID. And that's come through. The president himself has already approved this, signed this into law, the national ID system. What impact will this have on financial inclusion? How does it all work out and help more of the unbanked get access to loans?
We've always identified that as a key element that will actually fast-track everything. And for that purpose, the BSP actually has been an active collaborator with the other government agencies in getting this law enacted. One of the pain points in promoting financial inclusion is simply onboarding customers. People cannot get into the system for lack of ID.
But how do you convince the unbanked to save up if they're having a difficult meeting day-to-day living expenses? How do you convince those?
Well, okay, that's a very good question. But the way I think digitalization will happen, we have to position it to meet people's needs. And the number one need of people is to make payments. Based on data, about 88% of our adults do payment transactions of some kind. So by creating these payment rails, you're creating a way for people to pay their water bills, their electric bills. So then you get used to it. And then that becomes the avenue for credit. And if you want to get credit, the best way to gain credit is to show that you can save. So it is potentially reinforcing.
On the flip side, how do you convince banks to lend to the unbanked, knowing that they might not have collateral to show?
What we have learned from the microfinance experience is that credit providers are willing to provide credit without collateral under certain business models, and fintech has helped move that along. So it basically begins with small amounts. Then if you demonstrate the ability to be responsible for payments, then you get more and more. So there are now many kinds of business models that enable providers of credit, banks included, to reach out and give out credit in small amounts as an entry point towards more credit.
You've got two automated clearing houses that you just got started. That's PesoNet and InstaPay. Mm-hmm. What's the difference between the two?
Okay, PesoNet is batch electronic fund transfer. Basically, from your account, you can issue payment instructions to move value from your account to another account. The amount has no limit, unlike InstaPay, but it is not real time. Meaning there are kinds of payments that are not so time sensitive, but there's other considerations to it. So that's to provide flexibility. On the other hand, InstaPay is also account to account, initiated by the sender, but it is immediately available near real time, but it is limited up to 50,000 per instruction, but you can do as many instructions per day, and that's part of the risk management built around it. So these are just but the two priority use cases that we had identified, which we think will have a large impact on usage. But there are many others that can be created,
such as
those that are based on cards. This one can be digital by mobile phone. You can create a card-based ACH as well, and also what people call direct debit. This one is you don't push it, but it's a pool, what they call a pool. So let's say for utilities, so you don't have to bother pushing payment to the utility. They can already just draw from your account on pre-agreed terms. So those are the possibilities down the road.
Do you have a timeline for these exciting new ways to digitize?
You know, the way we've structured it, Kathy, is that it is private sector driven. It's not mandated by the BSP. It's a cooperative endeavor. So what we've done is created the cooperative framework for all providers, banks and non-banks, to decide what makes sense from the point of view of delivering services to customers. The two cases that we discussed, PesoNet, InstaPay, was the consensus that these are the most important ones. And the next ones will really be driven by the market. And we're happy to work with the market, what they want to prioritize next.
How are transaction volumes and values looking now for both InstaPay and PesoNet?
We are starting from a relatively low base for both, especially for InstaPay, which is really from nothing. But the growth rate is phenomenal. For example, for InstaPay in July, the volume more than doubled in the month of July from the previous one. It just started April. So it has momentum to it. And that's considering the fact that it's only now that the banks and non-banks are coming around to putting the system in place and connecting to the ACH. Today, last I looked, there are about 16 banks who can send and receive via InstaPay. But more are really rushing to be able to connect within the year.
So how soon do you think we'll reach critical mass when it comes to electronic transfers as well as payments? What's your timeline?
You know, the big we went out on a limb and said that by 2020 we want to see digitalization of retail payments at least 20% by 2020. We're starting from a very low base. When we first surveyed this back in 2013, we were at 1% level. But don't, you know, these things don't go linearly. So right now we're in the build-up phase. We're setting the foundations. Once these foundations are fully in place, the providers are there, and more importantly, merchants start adopting it so that the system becomes a closed loop, then it can become explosive. And when that happens, I think 20% by 2020 is not only very reachable, it can be easily surpassed.
How soon, if not 2020?
Well, by 2020, it should be
could
at least.
Could it be next year?
Hard to say, but if you're growing double every month, then by next year, then we should probably be there. But I think the important development that I'm focused on is to get the government to adopt digital payments. It's important because it's a major user for paying for payroll, for paying suppliers, for paying taxes and fees, for the government to pay out dividends and premium for GSIS, for example. So and the like. So it's a major use case. So once that is in place, that's going to be another major driver that will quantum leap usage.
So how do you see financial inclusion complementing what we talked about, your inflation targeting mandate at the Banco Central?
My view is that we have to take a much broader view. The effectiveness of the conduct of monetary policy is in a way very dependent on the efficiency of the transmission channel of policy to the financial system. Now, the financial system is going to be more effective and therefore a better channel if it is better, it is well developed. And there are many ways of looking at development. But I think an important element of development is the fact that it is relevant and inclusive to as many Filipinos as possible. So to the effect that people interact with the financial system more actively, then the impact of your policy changes, those little tweaks of 25 basis points, is more impactful on the financial system.
Did you ever envision the job to be the way it is, a central bank governor?
Yes. But, the continued D++ agenda, so I came at this, I have a clear agenda on my mind in terms of what I need to do. So for the first year I've been very preoccupied with pushing reforms across a broad swathe of areas, from digitalization to developing the debt markets and the foreign exchange markets. So these have been high on my agenda, Kathy, and then overarching that is financial inclusion. So obviously, 1 year is not going to be enough to matter on all of these fronts, but I look at the next 5 years as a great opportunity to build on the initiatives started so far. And with luck, with the support of the public and our continued enthusiasm, we'll be able to make a big difference by the time that I finish with my term.
Do you ever get to walk with your dog still every morning?
Oh, yeah. But not every morning. You know, I have a new distraction.
Which
now,
is?
Kathy. I have a grandson last
Beautiful.
May. So
congratulations.
Yep. Thank you very much. And one of the dogs actually kind of jealous that my attention is split. So every time, instead of patting him straight and I go straight to my grandson,
he nips me a little bit just to remind me I'm still your favorite.
What do your family think about your job this first year as central bank governor and the challenges you've had to face personally?
Well, I think they were more concerned about health, for example. So my wife keeps reminding me, this thing, you want to slow down and the like. And then and that's a useful reminder, you know, sometimes your enthusiasm gets the better of you and then you keep going. And before you know it, you have health challenges. So it's a useful reminder and I value that.
When we come back, colleagues, friends and family remember the legacy Espinilla left behind as governor, mentor and father.
So money for me right now symbolizes independence. If I want to have the absolute freedom to do whatever I want, then I have to be financially stable first.
Definitely a resource. It's a tool. It's something that I can use to allocate towards reaching my goals.
The more money you have, the more choices you have, the more tools you have, the easier it becomes to accomplish the things that you want to accomplish.
Governor of the Philippine Central Bank may have been short-lived, but all those who worked with agree, Nestor Espinilla Jr. left big shoes to fill. From former bosses to deputies, they all fondly recall how Espinilla was a man of action, championing financial inclusion while never losing sight of those around him. But what many may not know is that while Espinilla may have pushed for the central bank's digitalization initiatives, the late BSP chief was not exactly the most tech-savvy of all.
Together for a long time.
And it was.
Yeah, and it was. It proved to be a seamless transition. That's why his idea of his governorship was to have continuity plus. No? So that's good. And he started that. He had a lot of plans, no? That he wanted to perform, undertake in the BSP. Unfortunately, you know, he had to be a man in a hurry because we all know why that is so now. No? That's all the time he had left. Governor Espinilla was really a man of purpose. Everything that he did, there was an objective. There was a purpose for it. He really focused on what he was supposed to do. That's why I'd like to say that he has got this characteristic of, how do I call it, stick-to-itiveness, you know? He didn't stop until the job was done.
After about 9 months, 10 months, I think he said, Governor, I would like to go back to operation if it's okay with you. And I said yes, because I knew that he had the potential for really moving up the organization in the central bank at that time. So I did not prevent him, even though I knew it would be a big loss to me, because, you know, he was such an efficient assistant.
Governor is really an enabler. He doesn't want to accept or he doesn't want someone to say never, kumbaga, never say never for him. There's always this chance to do something, even if you're doing it for the first time. That openness about ideas is what he really is. So also always striving for efficiency. Also in those trying times, when you feel like almost all the institution would really be reacting, let's say, to an action by the BSP. He was so firm, really, and very supportive that, oh, we can really ride this out together, Chuchi. That was really a moment that I remember.
Despite his medical condition, he tried to provide his leadership and his guidance to the BSP in general. So it is something that one can say of the man. He went beyond his physical limitations, and we are all grateful for his unselfish some selfish attitude and concern for the BSP, even if he was physically suffering himself. He wanted everyone and Maria to have greater access to financial services and instruments, and in the process empower them.
That last message that I received from him, saying, you know, just keep going, and the journey may be too long, but rest assured that we will all reach the finish line. And I think he has provided the, you know, all these enabling regulations, and I think it's up for us. Those people who are in the ecosystem, who those who are who believe in him, would be the one to really continue that legacy.
His passing was quite a shock to me. I knew he was sick, but I was hoping that he would overcome it, because we would talk about, he told me that he was sick, we would talk about it, but you know, he's such a good man, very principled, and too young, and he's a big loss, not only to the banking sector, but to the government.
So on behalf of the United States Embassy and the U.S. government, I want to convey our deepest condolences to Governor Espanier's family, friends and colleagues. He was a great partner to the U.S. Embassy and the United States government. I think everyone knows that he was a tremendous banker, and it was a real privilege for us to work with him. And I think he contributed greatly to the Philippines' economic growth.
He was a mentor to so many people. Mentor in the sense that if they had an idea or a thought or potential that he saw in them, he went out of his way to make sure that they reached that full potential, whether it be connecting them with the correct people or finding opportunities for them for training or something like that. And it comes back to him in many forms. These individuals become committed or dedicated also to the platforms that he wanted to advance. They become committed to the institution. So I think may replicating factor yung kindness and generosity of sharing himself to others. So, yeah.
Did you ever feel that phrase, financial inclusion in the family, growing up with dad?
Yeah. Did we also... the thing with dad is, my role actually for my dad is that I was his secretary at home. My dad is what I find very ironic. He really advocated and spearheaded the digital payment systems and things like that, bringing our banking system into the modern era, right? But my dad himself, was not the most tech savvy person, and that was I'm testament to that, because he'd write all of his thoughts on in longhand on yellow paper, and then I was his secretary, I had to turn it into a word form on the computer. But that's the thing, that what I found even most impressive, because despite him not really knowing how to do things, he made an effort to understand, and he saw the potential of it for other people. So he really tried to make sure that this is a platform, this is something that could make everything more accessible to people.
And he learned a lot from home.
Oh, yeah.
Being tech savvy.
Yeah.
Like you said, he wasn't really tech savvy, but he was a very good saver. He did make a mention amongst all his siblings.
Yeah.
They'd come to him as if he were the bank, because he would keep his money, go studying, and not go out and party.
Yeah.
Did you feel the same kind of vibe when he was mentoring you as dad?
Well, the thing with my dad is he was a very simple man with very simple taste. He always taught us to be responsible and to take things like saving our future very seriously. And I guess that's also what I loved about him, was because while he could be very wise, and as a father, you know, it's always nice to have somebody who's ready to give advice, he was very approachable. If I may, kolokoy siya. As in, he would always say funny things to us. And so whenever he'd give advice, like, oh, you save for your future, it never felt like it was being said in a condescending manner. It felt like the advice of your wisest friend. So, yeah, I mean, we always took everything he said to heart.
We'll leave you with messages from those whose lives he's touched.
They say that it can be lonely at the top. Even when the going gets tough, my fervent wish is that I never lose sight of where I came from. Ako ay laking BSC.
Is how we start our day. Early edition, Mondays to Fridays, only on ANC, your news channel, your partner.
Getting into business can be a risky endeavor.
More often than not, plagued with hesitation, doubts, and challenges.
That's why we're here to give you tips on how to start,
give you expert advice on how to keep it running,
and make your business a success story. I'm Lexi Schultz.
And I'm Quinton Pastrana.
Join us as we help you take the plunge, decide, and create strategies to run your own business. On Shop Talk, every Friday, 7:30 p.m. Here on ANC, your news channel, your partner.
Fate, this love.
longing to go across the barriers of your trust anymore. 'Cause I will always hold the promise that I told you. We will never fall, 'cause we'll be stronger after all.
Watch ANC, and this is where I get my news. This also extends to a lot of people who become very dependent on Keeping Abreast with Developments and getting it straight from the people who know how best to do it, who have experience.
Access, credibility, and integrity. News that is empowering, from which they can make informed decisions.
Sign up that you're a 24/7 news channel. What's important is that you're able to supply all those hours of the week with relevant news.
We break business news first and fastest and provide context. We move markets. Then we do a deep dive on why it matters to everybody.
Intelligent sources, intelligent reporting. To be well-informed is the biggest power one can have.
Filipinos can be as industrious, dedicated, and conscientious as the citizens of progressive nations. When we come together for good, Filipinos can and will.